Google Kubernetes Engine helps you focus on your application while still being able to configure details of how your app can run. When it comes to cost optimization, you can fine-tune both your application and your GKE configuration, getting the most value for what you're spending and reducing wasted resources. Today, we'll talk about some tips and best practices for the application side of that. Let's go beyond your GKE bill. In the past few videos, we've spent a lot of time looking at optimizing GKE through monitoring, machine types, autoscaling, and more. If you haven't watched the previous videos, I'd suggest checking those out first, since a lot of specific optimization tips in this video and the next builds on those previous concepts. We're talking all about apps today, so I'll start with the resource side, then move on to some best practices for how to build your containers. After that, we'll talk about some ways to make sure that your app and Kubernetes are working well together. The best way to start is to repeat this. It is critical to know the details of your application and how it responds to demand. Monitoring can help understand what resources are used as demand increases. We covered monitoring earlier, but here's another tip. Try running your application as a single pod replica and then test it under load without any autoscaling. Once you have that information, use it to configure resource requests and limits, which we'll talk about in a minute. Then, test your app again with cluster autoscaling and horizontal or vertical autoscaling. Now, test large rapid spikes in demand to see how your app responds. No matter which tool you use to simulate demand, try to use the same region or zone as where your app is running. That way, you can minimize latency and focus on understanding all the details of how your app scales. And there's more you can do with that knowledge. Earlier in the monitoring video, we talked about resource quotas and limit ranges. You can also set resource requests and use limit ranges to control resources. With a resource request, you're defining how many resources your application actually needs to run. With a resource limit, you're defining the maximum amount of resources that your app is allowed to use. These will help Kubernetes figure out how to schedule your pods and ensure that they don't use up all the resources that are on the node. One best practice is to set your memory limit equal to your memory request, and to set your CPU limit higher than your CPU request, or you can even leave it unbounded. Kubernetes can always throttle the CPU that your pods are using down to the request amount if the CPU resources are in high demand. But the same doesn't work for memory, since Kubernetes needs to shut down pods when scaling and if there's too much demand on the memory. Of course, any form of autoscaling might not be very useful if your application can't scale. Vertical autoscaling, it's only effective if your application can actually use the additional resources on the nodes. In the same way, horizontal autoscaling is only effective if additional pod replicas actually let your app handle more demand. If the actual performance bottleneck is on something like a required database, more pods might actually make the problem worse. Either way, you can use the different autoscaling techniques that we went over in the previous videos to make a configuration that works best for your app. But if your app can't scale, you might need to consider refactoring to a structure that works well with Kubernetes. For example, single-threaded apps or apps that can only run a limited number of concurrent processes may not get much value out of the extra resources. If your app can scale, the next step is to look at spinning up and spinning down. Here are some best practices for minimizing startup times. Whenever the cluster autoscaler creates a new node, that node has to download the base image for each app that it'll run. The smaller your image is, the faster a node can download it. In the same way, use the smallest base image that your app actually needs to run. Also, try to minimize the amount of startup time needed to start handling requests. Startup tasks like loading classes and caches can significantly increase the amount of time between creation and then being ready, which could cause requests to fail while your app is spinning up. Check out the best practices for building containers link in the description below for more information. On the other side, you want to make sure that your app can shut down gracefully. If your workload has trouble shutting down, it can lead to delays and disruptions in service. When a pod is going to be shut down, it should receive a sig term. Instead of just assuming that everything is done, this is actually a signal to do some cleanup. First of all, you'll want to update your readiness probe to fail, more on that coming soon, so that requests will stop coming into the pod if you're using container-native load balancing, which we'll talk about in the next video. But your pod must still finish all the active requests, and any new ones that come in, since it can take a bit of time for Kubernetes to update where those requests are going to be delivered to. In addition to that, your pod should run any cleanup steps like persisting any in-memory state. If you're not handling SIGTERM, or you can't because your app is using a system that you don't actually have control over, like a web server or a reverse proxy, you can use the pre-stop hook. Here, your pod can run the same cleanup, and you can even put a sleep command in for a few seconds to postpone the SIGTERM. There's also a configuration to give your pods a bit more time to shut down. It's called termination grace period seconds. You should only change this if you really need it. By default, it's set to 30 seconds, but it can go all the way up to 10 minutes before the cluster autoscaler forcibly terminates it. Quick startups and proper shutdowns help your autoscalers work in a more reliable, more efficient, and cost-optimized way. The more specific you configure GKE to your application, the better it can run it. In the first video, we talked about pod disruption budgets, when you statically set the minimum number of pod replicas to keep your app running. Kubernetes will try to respect that number as it handles rollouts, upgrades, and autoscaling. It's not a guarantee when unexpected things happen, but it's still a best practice to define pod disruption budgets for every application. That way, your app will almost always have enough replicas to keep running effectively. In addition to those budgets, you'll also want to make sure that you're correctly setting readiness and liveness probes for your app. Kubernetes will use the readiness probe to know if each pod is ready to handle traffic, so you don't need to worry about race conditions between traffic and setup time. Liveness probes are used to tell if the pod is still alive and working, so if your application gets stuck or deadlocked, Kubernetes knows to restart it. These two probes are key to making sure that Kubernetes can optimize working with your app, and here are some best practices for working with them. Always define readiness probes for every container. Know when your application is actually ready. For example, if your app depends on a cache being loaded, the readiness probe should only say the pod is ready after that cache has been loaded. If your app doesn't need any startup time, define a simple readiness probe, such as just returning HTTP 200. Also, make sure the code for your probes is as simple and isolated as possible, so there's no blockers when Kubernetes is requesting the status. Your probe logic should try to avoid remote services, and if you have to use something remote, try to test against the simplest and hopefully fastest one. One more best practice for any and all of your services is to consider how to handle retries. Especially in a full microservices environment, a service call could fail for any number of reasons, like a network failure or rate limits. When there's a failure, it usually makes sense to retry the request in case it was something temporary. But if it's more permanent, you may end up sending lots of requests and potentially even overwhelming the destination. For both the way you call services and the way you create your own services, use exponential backoff to protect against overwhelming the service. In short, you just add a bit of time after the first failure, and then more if there's another failure, and continue exponentially. When calling a service, you can implement exponential backoff logic yourself, use a library, or even use Istio or Anthos service mesh that support a proxy-level retry, which handles it all for you. If your service is the one being called, you can rate limit requests from the same caller to force exponential backoff. You'll also want to prepare yourself for handling retried requests, so you don't end up duplicating functionality in a bad way. Bake transactions, for example. Of course, the specific details of how to implement that will depend on your application. These are some things to keep in mind when working with your application, and each one will give you different results. The key here is to really have your application and GKE work together as efficiently as possible. On the next video, we'll look at tips for optimizing GKE and do a wrap-up. Remember to check out the link in the description for the full guide on GKE cost optimization.